Thank you so much, Alice Ann. Thank you, Andrew, for being willing to pray. Thank you, Alyssa, for being willing to come up and let us know about your mission. Thank you, Winnie and Chris, who, although they were at the hospital still at 2 a.m. this morning, still showed up to play the piano and work in the sound booth. I mean, that's commitment. Appreciate it very much. And then there's so many both out in front and behind the scenes that do so much. We appreciate the work that you do for this part of the body of Christ. Well, I came across a quote by George Orwell, and I thought it was rather telling, particularly with our topic this morning. He said, "Public opinion, because of the tremendous urge to conformity in gregarious animals," and if you don't understand that, just read social creatures. "Public opinion, because of the tremendous urge to conformity in social creatures, is less tolerant than any system of law." What's he talking about here? Well, basically, he's talking about peer pressure, the pressure of our culture around us to make us behave a particular way. And if not, if we are unwilling to behave in that particular way, oh, well, we're in big trouble then. And the problem is exacerbated for those of us who are Christians because we are different. We are called to be different. We are supposed to be different. We are different because of what God has done in our hearts and in our lives. So we are in Ephesians. We are all the way to Ephesians 4, verses 17 through 24. So please join with me as I read. "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you and we thank you so much for your word to us. And sometimes your word is very challenging. And sometimes your word is hard to obey, particularly in the culture that we live in currently. Help us, Lord, take your message to heart. Move in us, we pray. Help us to hear you. Help us to love you. Help us to be willing to follow you. Help us to be willing to tell others about you. And dear Heavenly Father, if there's anyone here struggling to know you, struggling in their relationship with you, we pray that through the power of your Spirit, you will reach out to them in a special way and assure them of your love, your care, your desire for them to follow you. And dear Heavenly Father, I pray that as a result of being here, we will all want to follow you better. And it's in Jesus Christ's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Well, first of all, I want to say that Paul isn't just giving his opinion. He starts off by saying, "Now, this I say." And because of the way he talks in other places, some like to differentiate between the things that Paul thought and the things that God thought. Because he'll say something like, "I say, not I, but the Lord say," and it seemed to make a difference in what he's communicating. Well, in all reality, all he's doing at those points is saying that, well, as far as I can tell, Jesus didn't say this while he was here on this earth, but I'm passing on this information to you. And we understand that the information he's passing on to us is from God because what he's saying is being superintended by the Holy Spirit. That is the understanding of the Christian church and has been regarding the Bible for the last over 2,000 years, that God's Spirit was superintending the process. So Paul's words, even though he might say, "Well, I don't have any knowledge that Jesus actually said this, but I'm telling you this," that doesn't mean it's any less important or any less scripture. And here especially, he goes on to say that what he is telling us is not just his opinion. Now, this I say, he's also testifying in the Lord. This is something that he knows God said and wants to communicate to the Ephesians church, particularly because they're in a hotbed of immorality. They're in a culture that worships gods and goddesses and engages in all kinds of witchcraft and sexual deviant behavior. And that's just a part of the Roman Empire at this point. And he's saying, look, I have a message for you, but it's not just from me, it's from God, and you can bank on it. And the reason I think he can say that is because of Leviticus 11:44. He finishes this passage saying we're basically called to holiness. Well, that's what God wants us to be like because he himself is holy. Leviticus 11:44, for I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourself, therefore, and be holy, be different, be separate, because I am holy. This is definitively something that God has said and a way he wants us to be. So we are to be holy. We are not to be the way we were. We are no longer to walk as the Gentiles do. We are called to be different. We are made to be different. God has given a spirit into our hearts and our lives so that we can be different than the world around us. Because the world around us, non-believers, live in a certain way. Now, the Gentiles live in a particular way, Paul says here. We understand that that applies to the world around us. They live in a particular way. First of all, they engage in wrong thinking, futile thinking, useless thinking, empty thinking is the way Paul describes it here. They don't think properly when it comes to godly things. And we have an example of this from Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah 5:20 says, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe for those who get it all mixed up," from God's perspective, that do things exactly the wrong way. And Paul is challenging the behavior and morals of the day. And I got to tell you, Roman society has never been so in vogue as it is right now in our culture. Norms for relationships and sexuality are thrown aside. Sex is worshipped. Life is not sacred. In fact, we even take these things further in our day and age. Rational thought is thrown out the window. Biology is mutable. Children are turned into little adults and experimented on. And forgiveness, mercy, and grace are only offered if you conform fully and completely to the societal ethics of the day. Can you say cancel culture? Our culture engages in wrong thinking. It hasn't changed. It was that way back then. It's that way now. And they have a darkened understanding. And there are demonic overtones with what Paul says here. It's not just the fact that our own morality is messed up, that our thinking is wrong, but there are forces on the outside that want us to rebel against God. And he said this earlier in his letter in Ephesians 2:1-2. "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience." Satan wants us to fail, and he's actively working to get us to fail. And Peter said this in 1 Peter 5:8, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." Not only do we have our own sin nature, our own wrong thinking, but the society, those around us, Satan himself and his demonic forces want us to be sinful and engage in wrong behavior, want the world to be conformed to his view rather than God's view. And then Paul goes on to say, the Gentiles, and you were once dead, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them. This is the way non-believers are. This is the way we were, alienated from the life of God, dead, spiritually dead. Paul, once again, going back to Ephesians 2:1, and you were dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked. There's that once walked again, the way you were. And then we see this in Ephesians 2:12. Remember that you were at the time separated from Christ. Once again, this is the way you were. Separated from Christ, you Gentiles, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. No hope without God. And this is why the sacrifice of Jesus Christ is so important. Because Jesus Christ left heaven, came to this earth, lived a perfect life so that he could die on the cross for our sins. We were dead. We rebelled against God. We were engaged in wrong thinking. We had a demonic understanding. There was nothing that could bring us to God because we didn't want to be brought to him. So Jesus came and he died in our place. He took our sins upon himself. He paid the price for our evil so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be experience grace, so that we could know mercy. That's what Jesus Christ has done for us. And we have to be willing to say, God, I know I've done wrong. I believe in Jesus Christ. I want to follow him. That's the gospel. That's what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. We were separated. We were without God and had no hope. Paul says, you aren't that way anymore. And he goes on to describe the way non-believers are and the way we were. They are hard-hearted. And Jesus refers to this idea of being hard-hearted when he was speaking to people, and he quotes from Isaiah in describing the condition and their unwillingness to listen, repent, and believe. This is what we read in Matthew 13:15. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. Now, another way of saying this, and perhaps indicating an even greater hardening, is by saying that people are callous, which is what Paul goes on to say here. He says, not only are people hard-hearted, not only are non-believers hard-hearted, they are callous. Callous. And Paul refers to this callousness when he talks about the apostasy that is to come and the false teachers that will come in the end times. He says this in 1 Timothy 4:1-2. Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times, some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons through the insincerity of liars whose consciences are seared. Seared. That takes hard-heartedness to a whole another level. Seared. That means branded. And branded here is the idea that they're owned by their sinfulness and Satan. They aren't just hard-hearted. They're callous. They are owned by their sin and by Satan. This is the way we were. This is the way the unsaved world, this is the way non-believers are now. And then Paul goes on to say that they are self-indulgent, and I'm going to couple this with extremely sinful. They are self-indulgent and greedy to practice every kind of impurity. They are selfish, self-indulgent, and all that that implies. All they are concerned about is what they want, what they desire, what they think they need is. And there are two passages of Scripture that kind of are similar to this, that talk about the way non-believers are, the way the unsaved world is, the way that we used to be, the way we aren't supposed to be now. One is from 2 Timothy 3:1-5. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. And I like the end there. I like the end there, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. That can certainly apply to false teachers in the church, but I think it can apply to society as a whole as well, because society likes to think that they are virtuous, like to think that they have all the answers, like to think that they are above everybody else, but they don't really know the true God. There is a religion out there that deals with culture and society, and if you are not a part of it, then you are in big trouble. And then we go to Romans 1, 18 through 25. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. Here he's saying that the world out there should know that there is a God. We should have realized there was a God. We should have been willing to follow him. Just look around you. Look at this universe. Look at what he's made. We should have all known better. The world should know better. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their understanding and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator. That's what the world is like. That's the way we used to be. And you might want to say, well, I was never really that bad. Well, you might have not have gone to the culmination of sexual sins where Romans is taking it here, but you certainly had moral inversion. You weren't concerned about the things of God. You were concerned about the things you wanted. And you made what you wanted right in your own eyes, and you didn't really care about God. You were under the influence of demonic oppression and societal peer pressure. I mean, we all had to deal with that. We all engaged in selfishness and sin. In fact, unfortunately, we continue to struggle with those things as believers, which brings us to the next part. This is the way you were. This is the way the world is, Paul says. You are supposed to be different. Believers are supposed to live in a different way. And the church has a responsibility to teach holiness. But this is not the way you learned Christ, Paul says, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus. Now, Paul has just stated that everyone has been given a gift or gifts by God through his Spirit for the church. But then he goes on to say that there were certain people who had certain offices that were there to advance the teaching of God and the kingdom of God. And pastors and teachers were given especially for this purpose, to help the church, to guide the church, to teach the church and the people of God more about God and how they are supposed to live. And Paul gives an important reminder about the function of pastors through Timothy in 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 4. Paul says this, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. And unfortunately, a lot of what Paul says, to Timothy especially, about the things that are going to be apparent in the last days before Jesus Christ comes, seem to be coming true in our society today. But note here that Paul doesn't say the function of a pastor is to make people feel good. Now, that's what some people think the function of a pastor is. They're supposed to leave church and just be all warm and fuzzy, never being challenged or confronted about anything. That's wrong. That's absolutely wrong. That's appealing to itching ears. Pastors are to preach the word. They are to reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Then there may be sometimes you walk out of a church service and you feel absolutely good. And that's great. That's a part of the preaching, but it's only a part. We're always supposed to be challenged by the word of God. In fact, James says if you take up the mirror of the word and you look into it and you aren't willing to change, then it's useless. Because you're supposed to look into it and find what is wrong. Not just what you're doing right, but what is wrong. The church has a responsibility to teach the word of God, which means the church has a responsibility to teach holiness, which is Paul's point here. And being holy isn't automatic. It'd be nice if it was, but we are told to put off certain things and to put on other things. And this is interesting because this is used of clothing in the Greek, especially the idea of putting on a garment. You take off something, you put on something. And it's neat because the whole image of wearing clothing and taking off certain types of clothing and putting other clothing on is really apropos because your clothing does say something about what you're doing in life or what you're a part of. I mean, if you work at Al's, everybody knows it because of the clothing that you're wearing, right? I mean, people work in the business world. More often than not, they're still dressed up when they go out. If a person is working at a construction site, they're probably in jeans and maybe a flannel shirt. I mean, what you wear as clothing says something about who you are and what you're doing, and the same is true in Christian life. We're to put off certain things and put on something else. And the whole analogy falls apart when you look at Jerry, because no matter what Jerry is doing, he's always wearing the same thing. So this is true excluding Jerry, okay? All right. Jerry's the one up here in the shorts singing when it's 20 degrees outside. So that, for those of you who don't know who Jerry is, that's Jerry. Okay. So put off and put on. We have a responsibility. We have a part to play. God has given us the power. God has given us the ability. God has given us the insight. God has given us the wisdom. But we still have a part to play in the process. We can't just shove our Bible under our pillow and sleep on it and wake up the next day and expect to be holy. We have a part to play. Paul says this in Romans 6:13. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for righteousness. Once again, do not present yourself. You have a part to play. But present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. And he tells us here exactly what we're supposed to do. We need to turn away from sin. We need to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful desires. Put off. Get rid of it. Don't engage in those old behaviors anymore. Paul says this in Romans 6:11-12. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. And some have gotten upset in the history of the church because they said the church is always about what you shouldn't do. It should be about what you should do. And there's some truth to that. And Paul is going to get to that here because we're going to talk about the things you should do. But it's also about being holy, and being holy is a realization of some of the things you shouldn't do. And the church has come down really hard on people who have engaged in sometimes those things that they shouldn't do, and that's unfortunate. But in our own lives, when we look at the Word of God and we're confronted by it, we should recognize there are things we shouldn't do, and we should put them off. We should get rid of them. We should not engage in them. And we should ask for help if we need help, to not engage in those things. And we need then to submit to the Spirit. And the ESV here says, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, meaning that your mind needs to be changed, and you can do this in various ways, and there's ways we could talk about that, but there's also another way to understand this that gets to the same point, only I think with a little more spiritual emphasis. You could read this as saying, renewed by the Spirit in your minds. And that implies that God is doing the renewing work, but once again, we need to cooperate with him. In Titus 3, 4, and 5, we read this. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy. We are saved not because of something we do, but because of the grace and mercy of God. By the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. When we believe, when we ask Jesus Christ to forgive us based upon his sacrificial death on the cross, then the Spirit regenerates and renews us. The Spirit comes inside of us. The Spirit lives in us. The Spirit is our guide, is our help, is our comforter. That's the Spirit's job. And part of the Spirit's job then is to transform us and to transform our minds. And I like to say it this way. The Spirit of God gives us the want to, but we have to cooperate with that want to. Romans 12, 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. The Holy Spirit is at work in us. God has given us a precious gift in the Spirit. And he's at work in us to change us, but we have to yield, we have to submit, we have to want to be changed, we have to put off, and we have to put on, which is the third part. We need to embrace holiness. We need to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. And we go back to the very beginning again. We want to be like God. For I am the Lord your God, Leviticus 11:44. Consecrate yourself, therefore, and be holy, for I am holy. And we put on this new self by believing in Jesus and wanting to follow him, Romans 13:14. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. And by putting on Jesus, that means we follow him, we obey him, we live for him. And the way we do that is by looking at his word. Psalm 119:11 says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. So we put off, we recognize the things that are wrong. Part of the reason we're willing to recognize them is because of the renewing work of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and we yield to that calling, we yield to that knowledge, and we say, okay, we're not going to do that, but we are going to do this, and we know what we're supposed to do because the Word of God guides us into how we are supposed to live, and that's where Paul is going to take us now. Paul is going to take us to the things we're not supposed to do and the things we are supposed to do. He's going to get very specific. He's going to get very personal. He's going to get very invasive. So while we are going to exhort, we're also going to rebuke a little bit over the next few weeks. But we're rebuking ourselves. Don't ever think that I'm up here pointing a finger. I'm saying we're all in the same boat. We're all in this together. I love Red Green. That's my favorite quote from Red Green. We're all in this together. That's it. We're helping one another out. And as a body, as believers, we're working together with the Spirit inside of us, helping one another out. I happen to have the gift of the mouth. And my wife tells me that frequently. But anyway, it's interesting because there's something going on in contemporary Christian culture now that kind of plays into this a little bit, because there's something going on down in Asbury that some are calling the Asbury Revival. And I honestly, now you might get offended at this, but I think they're selling the term revival a little short, because I think what we have going on right now is an extended praise and worship concert, which is fine. It's been going on for over a week now. And the reason I say that is because in revival, true revival, what happens is holiness and change. It's not just about praise of God. It's about the Holy Spirit doing a transformational work, maybe in people who don't know Jesus Christ, but in people who know Christ. Revival, not regeneration, revival. Normally it happens within the church. Normally it's people within the church, people who know Christ, having their hearts change. And what I find intriguing about this is that I've been told that some that are in leadership and up on stage are engaging in lifestyles and, you know, their personal lifestyles and things that are more like the world than what God wants them to behave as far as their sexual desires. And what I want to suggest that is that if we see a movement of radical repentance among those who are involved and among those who are attending, that's when we can see a true revival going on. And I'm reminded of a story I read in Keith Green's biography. Any of you remember Keith Green, contemporary Christian artist, 70s, early 80s? He died tragically, left behind a wife and at least one or more children. So Keith Green, no compromise. He was doing a concert at a Christian school, and something happened. And they felt like the presence of the Holy Spirit was there. People were praising, people were weeping, people were expressing their love for God. And in the midst of it all, people started to come forward and confess their sinfulness. And what happened was, at one point, one member of the student body got up and confessed a sin that was absolutely forbidden at the school. And the school administration at that point decided, we've had enough of this. And they came up on stage and said, okay, we're done. And it's like, he said it was like the air was just sucked out of the auditorium. And you could argue, well, if that were really the Holy Spirit doing that, then it would have continued, maybe. But we're also told in Scripture that we can grieve and quench the Holy Spirit. And the person writing the book didn't choose to make a statement, just presented the facts that way. And the reason I think that's interesting is because throughout history, true revival has been accompanied by people confessing their sins and radically changing their lives. And if we see that come out of this, that's great. But I got to tell you, I've been around for, you know, we've had the Brownsville revival, there have been other Asbury revivals, there have been all kinds of things that were supposed to be revivals. And I don't know that we've seen one quite like the first and second great American, great awakenings in American culture. Something that really just spread across the country and people's hearts were changed and people were crying and people were asking God to forgive them. I mean, it's just, we want to, you know, be happy clappy and call it a revival. Is that a revival? Or are we looking for something deeper, something more meaningful, something truer? And in thinking about this, I want to conclude with a song by Keith Green. It's called My Eyes Are Dry. And I think this is our personal cry from our own hearts regarding the revival that we need to experience that maybe, if it's true, can spread.
My eyes are dry, my faith is old, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold, and I know how I ought to be alive. Soften it up with oil. of love, please wash me anew in the wine of your blood. My eyes are dry, my faith is old, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold.
Come to you now, and we acknowledge that we are not as holy as we should be. Help us to put off the sinful things that we were so involved with before we knew you and still tempt us to this day and time. Help us to put them off. Help us to yield to the Spirit working in our mind, changing our mind, helping us to change our lives, and help us to put on Christ. Help us to put on love and joy and peace and faithfulness and goodness and kindness and self-control. Help us, Lord, revive our hearts today. And it's in Jesus Christ's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen.